for her. I like that for her.
Okay, good luck.
Up against your home, the enemy came up against your children, the enemy came up against your name, the enemy came up against your character. You will win, win, you will. The enemy came up against your health. The enemy came up against your finances. The enemy came up against your vision. The enemy came up against your business. You will.
Everything attached to me wins.
Well, hello, hello, hello.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, hi.
Welcome to Talk About It Tuesday with Amber and LaShawn. We help women who have experienced trauma or loss discover their personal love story through self-care. Welcome this evening. Today is February the 1st.
It is the 1st of Feb. Oh, it's the first of the month. So it's my favorite month. It's the love month.
Yes.
Black History Month.
Yes.
Just amazing. I mean, it's a short month, but it's so powerful.
It is. It is. God can do a lot with a little. Yeah.
That's not like a whole word. A whole word.
that's the word right there. We might have to come back to that.
I'm thinking that maybe a private Thursday. I don't know. It sounds like a whole entire word.
You know, I've always got my mechanical pencil, so I write that down. There you go. So welcome, 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 you guys. So sis, do you want to share the title of Talk About It Tuesday?
I do. I want to find it first, and I am finding it. There it is. Don't litter on my emotional literacy.
All right. So those of you that have been our audience for a while know that I love a play on words. I love the word, and I love a play on words. And so don't litter on my emotional literacy. So the definition of emotional literacy is the ability to understand your emotions, listen to others, emphasize with their emotions, and to express your emotions productively.
Yeah.
So that is the definition right there. So that's kind of a lot packed into that definition. So we're not going to kind of fully dive into all of that. We had kind of expressed to you guys at the beginning of at the wrap up of psychological self-care and at the introduction of emotional self-care, that this is a segment that we're probably going to be in this. We're going to sit in this, as my sis says, for probably maybe about 8 weeks, because there's a lot of content and we do not believe in the spirit of rushing through things. So sis, would you like to open us up in prayer before we dive in any further?
Absolutely. Oh, Father God, thank you so much, Father God, just for being who you are. Father God, we love you. We adore you. We honor you. We thank you. Father God, we ask as Amber and I come with the word that you place on our heart to bring, that you speak through us, Father God. We ask you, Father God, to remove us from the view, from the lenses of those people that are watching now and that will watch later. Remove us and let them see your face. Let them see your glory. Let them see your light. Let them hear what you would have them to hear. And most of all, Father God, heal them where healing is needed. We trust you. We love you. We thank you. We honor you, Father God. And we're giving all of us to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. What a beautiful prayer. So last week we stated that we're never wrecked, that we're carefully navigating emotions. So what that means is that, you know, as things come, as they present, that we're just going to tackle it as it is, and that, you know, we're not emotionally shipwrecked in any way, because what we're going to do is that as emotions present, that we're just going to utilize our coping skills. And so as we're going through these segments, where our objective is that we are going to give you guys some tips and some techniques to help you to better and more effectively navigate emotions. So emotions have the potential to impact all aspects of our life. And so as Sis and I were talking earlier, our relationships, in our careers, our health and wellness, our self-esteem, and then also the regulation of emotions. Sis, can you think of any other areas also that maybe emotions and emotional literacy is impacted other than job, you know, relationships and things like that?
Just self, within self, right? Like if you're not understanding in your emotions, it can cause havoc in your world, right? Mm-hmm. But I think you hit on the major ones. It's really in relationships, like you said, in work, in your business, in anything you set out to do, you know? Right. You just need to be intact with your emotions. You need to understand them, understand what's happening, and be aware is the word I'm really looking for.
Absolutely. Yeah, self-aware.
Yeah.
That self-awareness piece. Because I think that when you are almost like emotionally illiterate, mm-hmm. that self-awareness piece is the missing piece, right?
It really is.
That's that missing link.
Yeah, I think I always say, you know, like when you and I are talking, the people that come into our life really have to be emotionally intelligent. Otherwise, they're not going to get us. Okay. And they're not going to feel comfortable within themselves. And they're going to have all kinds of things going on with them. Mm-hmm. And they're going to try to deflect, I think that's the right word, those things that they have wrong with them on us. But because of the emotional literacy and the emotional intelligence that we have, they can't. We'll let them take, you know, say whatever they need to say. Mm-hmm. Well, you'll let them say whatever they need to say. I may have words back, but I'm going to be real, right? But at the end of the day, we're still going to move. We got things to do because we're not going to take on their stuff. That's their stuff.
Right.
It's no place for us, right? So yeah, right. Emotional literacy is super important. And this title, Don't Litter on My Emotional Literacy, people try it all the time.
Well, and one of the things, you know, that we were talking about before we got on this evening, because one of the things that I'm going to say before I complete my sentence is when Sis and I, prior to getting on, we talk about the segment and process through it. We have our moment of kind of meditation and sitting in it. Life happens. So when we get on here, we share with you guys what's really happening in our lives and how these segments are really the things that are impacting us in our daily lives. And we share very candidly with you guys. Mm-hmm. So it's not like these hypotheticals. It's like, no, this is what happened to me yesterday, today, just a few moments ago. Right. Mm-hmm. And so when we were talking, we were processing through, you know, don't litter on my emotional literacy. You know, oftentimes when people are sharing with us or gifting us their opinions, as I say, is that they're gifting us from a place of where they are emotionally, right? And so God, in our humanity, we do not have the capacity to love from the perspective and standpoint of Father God, which is agape love, which is unconditional love that's not tainted at all, right? So people with their opinions and that they gift us with oftentimes can be gifted sometimes with razor blades. It can be, you know, gifted sometimes with recklessness, because even in the good intentions, we come from a judgmental space, and we're coming from a very limited space of knowledge, and we're coming from a limited space of love, because we don't have the potential to love someone without it coming from a space of limitation, because we're not limitless like our God is, right? So oftentimes, one of the ways in which the Bible speaks to us, it says in Matthew 6:33, is seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added to you. Well, that seek ye first the kingdom of God, oftentimes when we seek God's face before we run our mouths, right? When we seek God's face, God oftentimes will tell us, just pray for that person. It's not intended for you to say anything to that person. The only thing you're supposed to gift that person is just bringing a petition of prayer to me, because in our limited ability to love in an unconditional manner. The recklessness can be that we damage someone, right? We hurt someone, someone who's really in the healing process. And we don't mean to. We're very well intentioned in our opinions and our thought processes, right? In our compassion, but we're coming from a limited perspective.
That's so good. That's really good.
So I've done a lot more quietness and be still and quiet and know that I'm God.
Yeah.
Versus always gifting people my opinions, because sometimes it's really not a gift, but I'll give people my prayer. You know, I have my notebook, always got my notebook and my hand painted mechanical pencil, and I have a prayer list, and I'll add a person's name. I'll say, you know, would it be okay if I add you to my prayer list? Or also I'll, if someone gives me the specific details regarding something, I'll say, well, thank you so much. It's not necessary to gift me details, but when you do, it just allows me to pray more specifically for you. Right. I would never want to litter on someone's emotional literacy because of my limited space and my limited capacity to love. And I'm a good person. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, so sis, would you please introduce your beautiful self to our audience? And then also take a little bit of time to talk a little bit about how loss can litter on our emotional literacy.
Okay. Well, excuse me. First of all, I am LaShawn Gunnels. I am your Reconnection Life Coach. I help those who are struggling with the loss of a loved one or living with the loss of a loved one, a loss of a relationship, grow through that grief and step into their happiness with passion and on purpose. I really am probably about to change my title to happiness coach because it's just so fitting. But I also want to want people to understand you can be reconnected to happy in your new normal. So it's kind of reconnection happiness coach, but we just really do the hard work to get to that place of healing, that space of happiness and enjoying a full life, even while we go through the grieving process. Well, my sis also asked me to kind of give an example on with loss, how someone can litter on your litter on your emotional literacy. So I know for a fact, you know, being a woman that's lost a child, the ignoring of my emotions, the ignoring of what has happened in my life and my family, that was kind of littering on my emotions from others. You know, people, I lost a lot of connections because I can't really call those folks friends, you know, because now that they've pretty much showed their true colors, I make people uncomfortable, evidently, you know, because I have things that real life stuff happens to me. And so people kind of shied away and they just littered on that emotional, that I thought were friends. They littered on my emotional literacy. They didn't even want to be there to allow me to cry or to talk about my Patrice or any of that, right? They was like, deuces. So, you know, God is amazing because, you know, he allows certain things to happen for certain reasons. And in those things that happen, you know, he makes it clear. He makes it real clear on what you should do. And so chasing after those individuals that could not find it in their heart space to be there for me, it was time to just move on in life, right? So I think that's one way that people, and some people may not even understand it. It could be, like I said, they're uncomfortable. You don't know what to say a lot of times, but guess what? There was a lot of amazing girlfriends. I can name them to this day. They're in my book that didn't know what to say either, but they just let me be. And I will forever be grateful to those girls. They know who they are. I definitely recognize them I love them for who they are. So that's my example of, you know, while living with loss, how someone could definitely litter on your emotional literacy. So sister, oh, go ahead. Give me my accolades.
That is wonderful. Like that, that's beautiful. Well, because for one thing, I think that it can be uncomfortable for people. I think that people just are like, what do I do? You know, when dealing with the physical loss and, you know, inner transition of a person, just people feel uncomfortable in that space, right?
Yeah, but it also showed me, and the people who showed up for who they were, I still love them, but I showed me that they can't be in my close-knit circle, mm-hmm. and that's okay.
Right.
It's totally okay, you know? I will always love you. And if anyone comes on here that's friends of mine and listens to this later, this is not to make you feel bad. You are only able to do what you were able to do. And that's okay. But it just opened my eyes to, ooh, I can go call on LaTanya. I can go call on Andrea. I can go call on Tamika. You know what I'm saying? It made it so clear. And now it's nice to be able to add you to that list. I know you weren't here when we lost Patrice, but you're here. You know what I'm saying? But it just, because those who want to do uncomfortable, do life with you, those are your peeps.
Yeah, so true. One of the things that I learned from your book, Living with Loss and Mother's Love, is that empathizing with someone else's emotions doesn't mean you have to be, quote, doing anything. That could be something like just sitting quietly next to someone.
Yep. Or even they let me sit in my chair, balled up, and they just sat on the couch.
Mm-hmm.
And some were praying, I'm sure. Some mm-hmm. were just thinking really good thoughts. Please help her. You know, I mean, they just let me be, and they were just there. And that meant so much to me.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing. So my amazing sis. So my next question for you is, how can practicing mindfulness support emotional self-care?
Mindfulness. I know I say it all the time, y'all, but I'm going to keep saying it until you get it. Okay. That's just what I do. Mindfulness is the most best. How does that sound? Is that correct grammar? The most best. No, it's not. Mindfulness is the best way to not only just give yourself that sense of now being in the present, but it gives you gratitude, which changes your entire attitude. Because if you're mindful, if when we take the time right now and just be. It does something with a smile on your face because you're like, wow, I'm here in this gift God calls the present. And I'm just being. And it is so good. So mindfulness gives you permission to not worry about any of the stuff that's going on. Was at the job? A child or children aren't acting the way they need to, it just allows you to be. I'm not saying meditation, because meditation doesn't work for everybody, but mindfulness you can definitely practice. And it just helps you to stay in a place of gratitude. It helps you stay in a place of love. It helps you feel supported by your Heavenly Father. If you are somebody who is about the universe, it gets you in alignment. It's just an amazing practice. So I challenge you to just allow yourself to be, to not have to worry about anything. We practice on my Monday morning motivationals. We practice a mindfulness with breath work. It actually just gives you a chance to just understand the breaths that you're taking and really, really sit in those. And so for me, I'm in a space of, I do my breath work and then I'm like, I have to give God the praise for it. Because he could have chosen to not allow me to do this today, right? So, you know, I'm just so, like, grateful and blessed that he continues to put in me and pour in me the things that can help others as I help myself. And that's just the things that we do in my program, Monday Morning Motivationals as well. You guys come check us out.
Yes.
So I did a lot of talking. I'd love to hear about Breezy. What? Tell me a little bit about Miss Breezy, Amber with a Breezy Butterfly. Tell me a little bit.
So that was all amazing. My sister is like, she's so amazing. And I practiced those techniques right before, as we were getting set up, I actually did breathing techniques and was just like, Lord, just usher in the Holy Spirit and, you know, take us out of it and just usher in all you. So it really does work. It's great for relaxing and just, as my sis says, you know, ushering in peace and then letting go of the things that do not serve us. So we actually had like a mini coaching session before I came on here. So her coaching program works. Praise God. She's great. So I am Amber Thompson, otherwise known as Amber the Breezy Butterfly, and I help women who have experienced trauma at the hands of a parent and who no longer desire to live in pieces, but desire to just begin a journey of living their life in peace. And so if that resonates with you, come on over, because I have an 8-week coaching program that's just amazing, and we can begin that beautiful journey together. So, one of the ways in which I was talking to my sis about how trauma can litter our emotional literacy is by, it literally stunts our growth. So for example, I experienced trauma at the hands of a parent, and I was in that environment. I was living in that environment until I was 12 years old. And then I was blessed to be, you know, removed from that environment where there was, you know, domestic violence and sexual abuse and alcoholism that was in that environment. But what happened is, you know, we age chronologically. So year after year, I was having birthdays and I was getting older and, you know, becoming, going from being a child to a young adult to a young woman to now I'm 47 years old. But I remained on the inside, that 12-year-old kind of little girl that was broken into pieces, right? At the hands of that parent that had, you know, did all that trauma to me. And so because of that, you know, I had been littered on, literally, and it caused me to chronologically age. So I was getting older, you know, 31, 32, 33, 34, 47. And, but the little girl that was 12 years old inside me, you know, remained there. So that is the way in which we're talking, you know, trauma and the littering upon and how that can impact you. And so I very much had, you know, difficulty in the area of emotion, adapting to my environment, you know, even understanding and expressing emotion. You know, mm-hmm. I had a whole situation today that I was really trying to navigate through, and that little 12-year-old girl who is very much healing and healed and is strong and brave and courageous still has not really exercised that muscle all the time. And so sometimes I have to be reminded, like, you're brave, you're courageous, you got this, girl, you know. And so you just take it one situation at a time. And so that's the reason why we talk about, you know, you're not wrecked. You're just navigating, right? We are carefully navigating. So when we say carefully, we're taking care of ourselves as we're navigating through those emotions. And so one of the ways in which we can be supported in my coaching model is what I call the first 15. And so during the first 15 is where I encourage the participants in my coaching model to utilize the first 15 minutes of their day to journal, to listen to praise and worship, to pull out, you know, I always pull out my handy dandy mechanical pencil and then I'm a notebook. I know my sister like laughs at me because she's like, girl, like, could you graduate from that you know, and use your laptop. But I just, pen to paper is very cathartic for me. There's just something about that process. And I think it's just very tactile. That just means getting it out. So touching this to the paper, it gets it out of me. And then I'm able to process through those emotions. So I was telling her today before we came on live, I was like, I've got a lot of content that after Talk About Tuesday is over, that is going to go pencil to paper and just process through just kind of what was going on today as I was, you know, healing and peeling, you know, what is revealed can be healed. So that just means that when we come on here for these lives, we're real human people, that real human things have happened to, that we've gone through, that we're journeying through. And we're just blessed to come on here and be able to share our journey of healing as we just live life, right? We are living very blessed lives. So that is how the first 15 can support emotional self-care. It's just the process of journaling for me and then utilizing that first 15 minutes of the day. And so we don't ever ask you to do something that we don't also do ourselves. So in my coaching model, I have that. And then I have Thriving Thursday, where I break down scripture and I explain the word behind the words and just help you to understand that God is a very relatable God and wants to have a personal encounter with you. And so I go live on Facebook, and I will absolutely be in Oklahoma this week. So I will be going live on my YouTube without fail. Praise God. Then at 8:30 PM on Thursday. So it's Thriving Thursday with Amber the Breezy Butterfly from my YouTube page, and then also from Facebook, and it streams live. So you can be a part of that and come on our pages. And then of course we have Talk About It Tuesdays at 8:30 PM with both of us. So yay. And we will be going live on our YouTube page as soon as God gifts us what is going on with our channel. It's probably something very simple. But we have had business meetings and we have had trainings because we really believe in continuing education and bettering ourselves emotionally also. So we're working on that. So sis, would you like to talk about stop and time out?
Sure. You may have to help me through because you know me and my fumbling of our acronym.
Stop is our acronym. Mm-hmm. And that's our self-assessment acronym. And it's the word STOP, S-T-O-P. And the S is for stressors. And that's where you just stop. And it's the stressors in the environment. It can be the stressors on your body, mentally, emotionally. And you just kind of go head to toe. Is there anything that's stressing me out around you? Is there anything that's stressing me out? The T is for triggers. Same thing, a head to toe assessment. The things around me, right? We also have talked about we did our unplug to recharge challenge as well. You know, right. Social media is really big. So if you need to unplug to recharge, continue doing that. It doesn't have to be that you only did it for the 30-day challenge and then now you're, you know, back TikToking and Instagramming and Facebooking and YouTubing and whatever else is out there. Mm-hmm. You know, you can still unplug to recharge if necessary, because that can be a stressor, a trigger. The O is for observation. So observe, once again, head to toe, you know, do a full body assessment. If your head is hurting, if your blood pressure's up, if your heart is pounding, if you're restless, if you're not sleeping, if you're not eating appropriately. And then the P is for pause. That means pause and think about the data that you collected in the S, the T, and the O. And then, sis, talk to them about taking a time out and self-care Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah. So with that pause, this kind of goes into the timeout, right? Where you just kind of, you know, I like to call them fivers. You just, you know, take 5 minutes to do nothing. Take 5 minutes to do, as sis has said, with the stop, to analyze the stressors, the triggers, and observe what are you feeling right now. And then just kind of think that thing through and work. It doesn't take a long amount of time. And I see, I think a lot of us, because we've run from our emotions and we've run from our feelings because we're not allowed to do this. And if we cry, we're looked at this way and all this other stuff that society has placed on us. We don't know. We don't even give ourselves that gift of taking the time out. That's part of self-care. Just giving yourself the time to do some breath work. Time out. Giving yourself time to assist it, says she does in the first for her first 15. What I do for her first 15 is I actually meditate, do a visualization meditation for my first 15 in prayer and read a word and share the word for my first 15. Those are the things that I do my first 15. She journals and lets Holy Spirit speak to her, and she gets to in her writing mode with her beautiful mechanical pencil and paper. I know I make fun of it, but I know that's therapeutic for my sister. So I'm grateful and thankful for that that mechanical pencil and that paper. But timeouts are so super important. But also the big timeout, like, if you just take care of yourself every day by doing a timeout, I challenge you, do a timeout every day, 5 minutes, just 5 minutes every day. Then when you get into your weekend and you're able to get into you can actually like plan out a huge celebration for you doing what you need to do. So I do self-care Sundays, and this is my regimen. Wake up, shower, get myself together. I'm on virtual church. I used to be lazy with it. I used to be really lazy with it, but Holy Spirit spoke to me and was like, you have to stop. And he spoke through me to me once I had seen, once I was asked to pray, and he was like, that's what you're supposed to do all the time, whether you're seen by people or not. You are getting yourself together for me. Okay. Toes out. Okay. So get up, get my shower in, get myself together, put on a nice, you know, jeans and a nice shirt, whatever I decide to wear that day. Get myself prepared for the word of God that my church, the Alive Church, our church actually, Amber just joined, the Alive Church, Kansas City. Watch my amazing pastor, Roman D. Harris, and my awesomeness, First Lady, Lady E, her name is Erica Harris, do what God would have them to do. And then after that, you know, it depends on what Sunday it is. If it's a hair washing Sunday, I go wash my hair and just like re-braid it and give it all the treatments that it needs from the oils and all that fun stuff. If it's a nail doing day, I'll go get my nails done, my toes done. So there's different things that I've set aside for my self-care Sundays. I allow myself to relax and watch whatever shows I may have recorded on my DVR, so I can just catch up on senseless TV. Yes, that's me caring for me because I love it. It is what it is. But I just go into my Monday. I end my night amazingly and go into my Monday feeling like, ooh, I just had a whole vacation. Real quick. Hey, sis, Brandy. She is watching. She has tuned in. She said, hello, ladies. So
hi, Kitty Pie.
Yes. Welcome. Welcome. Thank you for joining. So, so that's some of the things that, that I do for my, self-care Sunday. If I'm not gonna, you know, do nails or anything like that, the nice hot bubble bath in the jacuzzi tub, that's like my fave. As soon as I don't go to that area of my house much because there's some work that needs to be done, but sometimes I'll just go ahead and ignore everything that's around it because the bathroom is actually beautiful down there. So I may do that as well. So it's just whatever, you know, it's like, okay, what do we want to celebrate with now, and however we want to celebrate yourself. You've done amazing with applying self-care and putting yourself first this week. So what are you going to do to celebrate that thing? So sis, I know you do Saturdays and Sundays, right?
I do. And I have better in the area of self-care. One of the things that I'm going to point out before I answer that question is that during our psychological self-care segment, we did a segment called Applied Practice versus Applied. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to point out that the reason why we titled it Practiced versus Applied is because we really encourage you to practice self-care daily. When you practice self-care daily, then you don't have to apply Band-Aids to the walking wounded, right? Because then it's not a 911 emergency situation where we're wrecked. That's what we're talking about when we say we're never wrecked. We're just carefully navigating our emotions. Because when we care for ourselves fully, right? That's where the play on words come in, you guys. There is a method to all of the things. Seriously, there's a method to my madness. I'm mad about God, right? So when we care fully, then we can navigate through things, and then we're not the walking wounded, because we really truly are practicing, you know, versus applying, right?
Yes, and that's so profound. I still want you to share this, but that's so profound on what my sister just shared, because, you know, think about that. When you practice it every day, and you perfectly practice it every day, we got that word from on Sunday.
Yeah.
When your day comes, a word you're going to like celebrate that thing, it doesn't feel like a lot. Have you ever had, you know, when you what maybe I'm gonna ask this question, you says, because I know I have. When you weren't practicing self-care, and then you're like, I'm gonna just do a self-care, you were so drained. You didn't even enjoy it.
Right?
Because you hadn't taken care of yourself at all throughout the entire week, months probably. So then you're like, okay, I'm just going to take care of myself today. And then you're just like, you can't even enjoy it.
Right.
So that's why we say take care of yourself every day, every single day. There's no excuse. It doesn't have to be elaborate. It's the breath work. It's just being mindful. It's being aware of what you're feeling and being real with that. It's being giving yourself grace. Those are the techniques for self-care on a day-to-day basis. Then you celebrate that thing. You get your gratitude journal. What am I grateful for today?
Absolutely.
Self-care. So I want to hear from my sis. Tell us some of the things you do for your self-care Saturdays and or Sundays.
So on Saturdays, a lot of times, like I'll do my toes and nails, and then it's a veg out day. It's a day when I typically am not going to cook. I'm probably going to just get something or pick up something, you know. I've really been focused more intentional about putting healthy things in my body. Mm-hmm. But I'll go, you know, maybe go out and get a salad or go out and get something. But I also treat myself now. Mm-hmm. So anybody who knows me knows that I love coffee, not just any coffee, but hot coffee. So where I used to just do more for other people, now I make sure that I, you know, take the time to get out and go and maybe drive to go treat myself to like a Starbucks coffee or a Panera Bread coffee or something like that. And then I just love just getting out, you know, just venturing out or whatever, and doing stuff like that. And then coming in, and I'm really good on like, I love binge watching things. And my sister's like, she's totally opposite of me. Like I'll get some, watch something like period type movies where it's like, you know, in the 1800s, and it's like on BBC, like British Movie Network. And she's like, I'm totally not going to do that. And that's totally me. Or, and so while she's watching Housewives, I'm totally not opposed to Housewives. I love them too. But yeah, I'll totally do something like that. Or I love reading a book. I love doing math for fun. I know that sounds like totally crazy, but I'll do like math workbooks for fun. That's my day. My kids, I know that if one of my kids or two of my kids pop on here, they're like, she really does do that for fun. And that's just kind of my brain activities and exercises and stuff. So things like that are exciting and fun for me. And that's just a typical breezy butterfly day. They're like, so you are sitting there eating a healthy salad, doing math.
Yeah.
And I do love a jacuzzi bathtub because in my house, I purchased my home for the jacuzzi tub. I totally did. So I love an amazing bubble bath. An occasional glass of wine or something like that. So yeah, that's totally an amazing day for me.
Mm-hmm. That's so fantastic. So fantastic. So we also want to hear from you guys. I mean, go ahead and let us know in the comments, what do you do to celebrate you taking care of yourself all week? You know, and how does it feel when you, or maybe you're not there yet. Maybe that's the first step. You need to actually start taking care of yourself. Be intentional on taking care of yourself every day, Sunday through Saturday. And then that following weekend, you know, Saturday or Sunday, whichever day you choose, celebrate it with something huge, something big. And let us know how you feel. Like, it doesn't feel like it's a whole big thing and you're just like drained. I'm more than positive you're going to feel like, oh my gosh, where has this been all my life? Because that's how I was. I was like, I was doing it wrong.
Because we encourage you guys to just start somewhere.
Start somewhere.
With a little bit of why we're like, just choose a day.
Exactly. Choose a day. It doesn't mean you have to be the whole week. Just be intentional for that day. And then if it feels really good, go ahead and be intentional for the next day. It doesn't have to be hard. So what else do we have, sis?
Yeah. And then our motto is that we're better together, you guys. So as we wrap up this segment, we are better together. And then also there is a direct correlation. We say this all the time, but there is a direct correlation between physical health and spiritual growth. And so our verse is from John 6:35. And so I will read that verse and then we will be wrapped up. We don't have any comments in the chat.
One comment. Brandy says she watches Housewives too. I knew I loved her.
She's a keeper.
She's definitely a keeper.
One of the things I want to ask everyone too is that if you come on later, just please place #replay in the comments because we love connecting with people. The other thing is place the city and state where you are joining from because we just love to be intrigued by where people are joining from.
Absolutely. We love it.
Yeah. Yes. So Jesus replied to them, I am the bread of life. The one who comes to me will never be hungry. And the one who believes in me as Savior will never be thirsty, for that one will be sustained spiritually. And that comes from John 6:35. And as I stated before, there is a direct correlation between physical health and spiritual growth. And so we encourage you guys, just start somewhere. We never ask you guys to do something that we are not doing ourselves.
Never.
So we thank you guys so much for joining us this evening.
One more comment, sis.
One more comment.
Brandy says, she celebrates herself by taking a hot bath and reading an inspirational book. I love it.
Yes.
I love it.
Yeah. Keep doing it.
Leave, you guys, you know how we leave out of here. We're going to go ahead and get your blessing.
Yeah. And you guys, next week, remember to do your homework. And that is our challenge regarding in your first 15 to please journal about reflecting on your feelings. So just make time to do that.
Yeah.
We're going to also be reflecting on our feelings. We're doing that every single day over the next month of February, during the month of February.
Yep.
We thank you guys for joining us.
You see where you're gonna be growing, getting better. You're not the
your muscle. Now you're stronger than you've ever been. They can't stop your hustle. Your faith ain't never small. That's what brought you this far.
Oh, yeah.
See, you got your dreams and you got your prayers and you got your God. He gon' take you there. Uh-huh. See, everybody has a season. And I believe this one's yours. Cause you've been working, waiting. This what you've been praying for.
Go get, go get, go get,
go get,
go get,
go get your blessing.
Go get,
go get,
go get,
go get,
go get,
go get. It's your time.
It's your time.
It's your time.
It's your time.
It's my
time.
You were made to live a good life, and that's what I believe. So hit the floor, say a prayer, start working. You gotta
get a tech guy or girl. It can be a girl. You sure can. Well, y'all have the most terrific Tuesday evening ever. We love you, and we will see you same time, same channel. Well, different channel. We're going to have our YouTube up and going in the name of Jesus. Same, but you'll see us on Facebook where you can click on it and still come on and join over there. We'll see you next week. We love you. Love and blessings always. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.